Hello there, Mr. Automation again, and this time this will be a part of several videos, and this is how you set up your own CI/CD environment with free tools, so it won't cost you a penny, so to speak, only some effort. And part one is how you install a GitLab server. I use GitLab for this example. So we go to the agenda. Let me see. So we're going to install a CentOS box, and this time I will do it automatically as well, but I'll also show you how it's done manually, because if you want to set up your own environment, you probably have no automation in place yet, so you need to do that manually. So I'll show you a little bit how it works. When we have the CentOS 7 box up and running, we install GitLab, go to configure GitLab, go to log into the web interface of Git. You need to change the password when you did do fresh install. Then we add some SSH keys so we can actually do git clones and git commits, you know, from the command line. We're going to create a project, we clone the project and prove that it works as well, you know. So we're going to change some stuff and then push it back to that new Git environment and see that everything works fine. So the next slide, download an ISO file. So let me open a browser here. I could do that here, I think. And download CentOS 7. I use CentOS 7, you can use 8 as well, but honestly I have a feeling that CentOS 8 and Red Hat 8 is slower than CentOS 7 and Red Hat 7. I don't know why it is. Can be a feeling of me, but I rather don't use 8, honestly. Probably just like Microsoft, you know, they have like a crappy version and a very good one, like Windows Millennium was horrible, of course, and then Windows 2000 came and XP that was fine, and then you had Vista that was horrible, and then you get Windows 7 that was fine, and then Windows 8, it's not really optimal, and now we have Windows 10, so you know, perhaps Linux does that as well. So I skipped version 8 for my personal reasons, but it should not stop you. You can do this as well on CentOS 8 or Red Hat 8. So you can download an ISO file. I'm not going to do that now because you see my internet access is blocked for this specific protocol. I think it's using FTP or something like that. Doesn't matter. I'm sure you will be able to download it yourself. So, and when you have downloaded it, let me see where I have it. I think I have here some ISO files. ISO files. No, it's an operating system. And then we have Linux. And then, for instance, you have downloaded this CentOS 7 DVD, right? So what you can do is create a virtual machine, of course, if you have like a virtual box installed, so Oracle virtual box, for instance. If you launch this, you can sort of create a new VM here, you know, and then you can also point to that ISO file and install it, but we do it a little bit different because I have a little bit better environment than virtual box. That's more, you know, for your laptop. You know, I have a whole cluster here with, 177 machines, so I can probably host another one. So we create a new virtual machine and, give it a name. Hang on. And I call it test 2. The most important part is, of course, I will assign some memory on it. Of course, you need to have like a network, but I'll show you like the installation process. So we add an hard disk, and then we also want to mount an ISO file. And I use Hyper-V, the cluster manager, so my interface look like this. But if you have VMware or VirtualBox or whatever you're using, you can mount an ISO file to a system, right? That's basically what you need to do here. So not CentOS 8, CentOS 7, one of the latest builds, that's fine. Next, I do finish. So that sort of works the same for each hypervisor. If you have VirtualBox or VMware workstation, it doesn't matter. You can create a VM and attach an ISO file. So that's the first step. And now let us see if we have that test. We have that test one here. So let's connect to that guy. And I will move that to the right. We don't need that anymore. And I will switch it on. And the first thing I need to do is probably disable secure boot and boot from a DVD. So that's fine, right? I boot from this CentOS installation. So we start that now. So you get the, and you don't want to test, you want to install CentOS. So you select that. And then we get like an installation menu in a second. So hang on. This installer is launching now, and then we get some graphical user interfacing. You see the mouse is already loaded here, you see that? So we get some graphical user interface. And I just want to show you now, if you've never done this. So you do continue here, English. Of course, if you are in Africa, you can change that. Whatever you like. I will continue, I like English. And here you can set the time. I live in Amsterdam, so let me put the time there somewhere. Honestly, don't care much, it's just a demo. You always need to confirm sort of your partitioning. If you're like a white guy, you can configure the partitioning yourself, you know, with the logical volume manager of Linux, but I will do the default partitioning now for this disk. You can provide a host name. I would suggest provide something sensible here, you know. I called it test2. I got test2. This is very important because you want to have a network, so always enable this, otherwise you don't have a network connection. If you don't have DHCP like I have, you see I already have here DNS server, default route, I have an IP address, I have a subnet, everything is configured. If that's not the case, you can go to configure and just configure your stuff here, right? Like the manual IP address and such, like here, you see? Here you can configure stuff yourself. I have DHCP, but you can do manual. And then add your information there if needed. So we do an apply here. Maybe do done there on top. And now basically this is good enough to start the installation. You don't need anything more installed. No, it's perfect this way. So we do the begin installation. And now basically the installation is already running, but you need to create a root password. So I'll create a password here. This will be the root account for your Linux box, otherwise you can't access it, of course, because there's no user. And you can create additional users, for instance, if you want to create Mark, you can do that. We can even make it an administrator. So you can do some stuff here. Create an account. I won't do that now, by the way. I'll leave this all out. So, I'm not going to create a user. Not going to show you this whole installation process because it takes a lot of time. You don't need to do anything. It's just spinning now. And I'll show you when it's done, what you see, so to speak. So let me open a system I just deployed for this demo purpose. I will destroy the other one we're deploying now. So for instance, when you're done deploying, you get like a login screen here. And you can log in with your root and with your password you just set for your CentOS installation. And there you go. And then you're logged on. Who am I? Host name. This one is GitLab 01. I just created that for this demo purpose. It's an empty CentOS box, the same as the one we're building, deploying here. So when this installation screen is finished, you sort of get this and then you can log on. So I will stop this whole rubbish on this test system. We don't need that. So let me see the... So we downloaded an ISO. I did not do that, but I mounted it. I created the VM from that ISO. We followed the installation screen. You can set a static IP or DHCP, I showed you. You need to have some DNS, of course, name resolution. Otherwise, you're kind of stuck, of course, so let me show that as well. So, for instance, you need to be able to ping something, right? I not just ping the outside. Oh, let me ping something inside, by the way, because that's more important. So I can ping my DNS server that runs on this guy, it's home.locals, so and I can resolve my service. That's very important later on, not yet. But at some point, we're going to add components like Jenkins and SaltStack, and then yeah, you need to have some name resolution in place, of course. Okay, we pinged something to prove that we can resolve names, so we have that. Okay, now we're going to do the actual part of installing GitLab, and I have now a sort of console session open. I cannot copy and paste to this, so I will open a remote shell to this GitLab server, and I will log in with root via SSH. So I'll do that now. So let me do an SSH root at, how did we call it? GitLab 01. I said 01. Password, asking for a password. Fine with that. Yes. Where am I? I said, who am I? Host name. Yes, perfect. So I'm there now remotely. Size it up a little bit. You can see that video clear screen there. So I avoid this interface, so to speak. So now we're that's in a second. So we're going to install GitLab. It's not hard at all. You know, it's Linux. Linux, it's often so easy. You know, there's so many examples online for Windows as well, of course. But I think Linux is often a little bit easier to install. I think if you install GitLab on Windows, you will have a harder time, I think. let me check. So we're on the server now, and we need to run some commands. And I'll show you which commands as well. And what we'll do is I need to do the properly. Yeah, this is the start point, so to speak. So the first thing we do, we install some dependencies, some packages. We need curl, policy core, utils, OpenSSH, client, and postlets. I don't know if it's installed. I just ran it, you know. We will see if something needs to be configured. So hang on. Let's wait a little bit for that. And okay, nothing to do. It's already installed, so that's good. Then we run a command to start SSHD. It's not needed, of course. I'm already logged on. I just show you the steps you shouldn't take, probably, if you are doing this on the console. Probably SSHD perhaps is not yet started, you know. So we start that. We do the start of the postfix that we just installed. We enable SSHD. It's not needed, but just show you the steps, you know. You can sort of follow all these steps in this order and you will get the working GitLab environment. So system control, enable postfix. Now we're actually going to download from this URL. So you do a curl, and that's why we needed to install curl, of course, and minus s, and we go to this GitLab, and there is a shell script there, and we sudo that to bash, and inside of that shell script there's a lot of downloads going on, and I think it's a repository configuration as such, it's RPM. So we run that. So this sort of makes the binaries for GitLab CE available on your CentOS box, so you can actually install it with Yum. So we press enter now, and this will take some time. And of course, needless to say, you need to be able to reach out to that remote location. Here on packages, you see GitLab. If you can't reach that, yeah, then you cannot download it, of course. That makes sense, I guess. And I'll pause the video a little bit, I think. See, it's importing the GPG key already from GitLab. Okay, yes, I'm recording. I always check that a little bit. So the repository setup, you can now install packages. So we can do that. And let me see, we now do a yum install of GitLab CE. So that's that. And if you're not elevated, you do a sudo, of course, but I'm already running as root, so it makes no sense to add sudo in front of that. And we're going to install GitLab CE, and it will take some time, so I will pause this again. You know, it's boring to watch. And as you can see or notice on the screen, it's a quite large installer. You see, it's already like 800 megabytes here, so I did not expect it. It's quite huge, GitLab, nice. There's a lot of functionality inside of that, I guess. By the way, I can show a little bit. I prepared the video a little bit, you know, and here I have some command lines we need to run sort of in which order, and so that's why I give this demo. But as you can see, it's so easy. Basically, if you have all the prerequisites installed, it's like running, I think, 5 commands, modifying 1 Ruby file, run the GitLab pre-configure, and you're done. It's really up and running. It's really nice, honestly. Yes, it looks like we have something installed. And you see this GitLab here, this asterisks, and you see the GitLab icon there in the shell. So it has been installed, and let's see what's the next step, because we know that. So that basically means that we go to the GitLab directory. So we do a change directory on etc GitLab, because that's where it installed. And then we open GitLab with, I don't think I have Vim installed by default, so we take VI. And we open the GitLab .ruby file. That's a Ruby file. And if you go down a little bit, you will find the external URL, and that points to gitlab.example.com. And we don't want that, of course, because we have a server called GitLab 01. And when you do GitLab, I need to insert first. GitLab 01. .home.log. That's my name, of course. In your environment, you can do something else. You can even stick an IP name in here, your IP address, if you don't have name resolving wise. But I would not suggest to use IP addresses, because that's horrible to get certificates up and running, so to speak. It's quite impossible. You need to have some sort of name resolution for certificates to work. So I'll save this. I'll do escape and I'll do a shift ZZ. It's the easy way to exit and save VI. Let's see what we do next. So after that, we do a GitLab CTL reconfigure. And what that means, basically, it's reads this Ruby file, and this GitLab CTL reconfigures the whole system for us. And we only change the URL, but it doesn't matter. We never run this configuration yet, so. And I can warn you up front, if you don't have much memory or CPU power, it will take some time. It's pretty heavy operation. There's a lot of stuff happening in the background. So be a little bit patient with it. Sometimes you think it doesn't do anything, but it's still running. And I'll show that now. You see, now you think there's not much activity going on. But you think this action run is not running, but it is running. So you're sort of waiting now for stuff. And that happens a lot with this installation. So I'll show that once or twice, and then I'll pause the video. And I'll resume on the installation. Then you see that? So again, and now you have a feeling there's nothing happening, but there is a lot happening. So you really need to wait until everything finishes, and it takes a considerable amount of time. So keep that in mind. By the way, the installation is still running. It really takes a lot of time, and I'll show you already, and I indicated that already, I mean. Look, I have 8 gigabytes of RAM and 4 CPUs at my disposal, and trust me, I have plenty of CPU power on that system, so that's really not the issue, so to speak, so I'm going to show that as well. It's really a heavy installer, so... Just look at this, you know, this is one of the hypervisors, so it has plenty of memory and CPU power available. And still, finally, GitLab reconfigured. Yeah, so we have something now. So let me check this slide. So we installed GitLab and we did the commands.shell. So yeah, let me see if we run them all. Of course, we need to do some more stuff. For instance, you want to add a firewall rule to enable SSH if you did not do that. So I just want to be as complete as possible. It's probably not needed, but still, I'll show you what you need to do. So it's already enabled, the firewall. Doesn't matter. We do the same for HTTP. We're going to access the server in a minute, and then the firewall, of course, needs to be opened. And we do a firewall permanent on HTTPS. Perhaps you have a certificate later. Or we get to redirect it to a self-signed certificate, I think so. Then it's very important to start. I think it's this one. Yes, we need to reload the firewall. I think the other ones, the start and enable, is not really needed, but we're in them anyway, so it doesn't matter. So I will enable it here. So of course, enable. We will list all. That makes no sense, by the way, because that's just showing. What's configured, and I'll show that, and you will see those stuff here. You see HTTP, HTTPS, SSH is allowed. Yeah, so this was the installation. I think we can open the web interface of that server, and let me open a browser for that. Oh, we already had that here, so let me do GitLab 01.home.local. It's already there. Let me see. It's not secure. Okay, that's perfect. Can you see here? Change your password. New password. You see that here? Change your password. That's because we did a fresh installation. We open the web interface. And now we type a new password for the admin. And the admin is root. Keep that in mind. So this is not the root user on your Linux system, but inside of Git. It's your internal user there. So don't be afraid that you're resetting your root password here. So I will create a password here for this user, for this new root user. course, we can create users afterwards. Change your password. Update password. And now we can actually log in. So I can do root and I can log into the guy. Let's see. Okay. Fair enough. So we now have an empty GitLab environment at our disposal. We can play with that. Type a new password. Did it? We logged in with the root. We set SSH keys. Yes, that's quite important. Let's do that. Yeah, and as you know, SSH keys are sort of meaningless. You know, they have no, they're not bound to an account. They can live everywhere. You can do whatever you want with it. You know, as long as you have the private key. If that has a password, of course, you need to have the password as well. But otherwise, yeah, it's not really limitations. You know, you can put it sort of anywhere. So let's do that. So we just go to the server. You know, you can just run this, and it will put it in a default location. I will accept that for now. I'll just show you what you need to do. You know, and I can enter a passphrase from my private key. It's of course recommended to do that. You know, just put a password on there. Honestly, I'm a little bit lazy, but I'm going to do a password still. We have a password now. Now, basically it's done. And now you have a couple of files. This one is root SSH pub, and it's now in root because I'm the root user. That has some content. You see this. And you have the same for your public key. It's a little bit longer. Show that. See that? Looks a little bit different. I'm doing twice the same, by the way. Hang on. That's your private key. And it's a little bit longer. Okay. So I clear the screen. And I'll do a listing here so you can see what's inside of this directory. There you can see you have two files there, id.rsa and a public key. This one is your private key, so you're not keep that in a safe space, a place, so to speak. But the fun thing is this private key, you can use it anywhere, on Windows, on Linux, on Unix, on Macintosh. It doesn't matter, you know, it's not bound to you or anything. It's just a key, and you give it sort of a sensible purpose. And this time the purpose will be git. And so what we do a cut of that file. Again, the ID, and we do the pub. And this one, we stick on our clipboard and we go to here, to GitLab. And you can go to the admin area, but also if you already logged in, so to speak, you can go to the settings of yourself. And then on the left side, you have SSH keys. By default, it's empty. So you cannot SSH to GitLab yet. If you want to do git clone on the command line, you know, you want to do that, of course, automatically. You don't. So that's why we add that key here. And now you see it comes from good root.gov. You can give it any title. That's why I told you it's really meaningless. This doesn't mean anything. You can stick in anything you like, I think, even. You can put an expiration date. It doesn't matter. So we add that now. And now this SSH key, so to speak, is accepted on this GitLab environment to do git pulls and pushes, for instance. And let me see if we can actually do that. Let's go to GitLab. Let's create an empty project, create a blank project, and okay, test. It's root, it's there, it's an internal project. Let's have a look. Okay, now we create a new file. And new file. test.txt. Create that file. And we add some content here. Okay. Commit. By the way, it's a nice interface. It's pretty new. I'm not really familiar with this one. I'm still working with an older version. So This is the sort of web IDE. Oh, it's pretty cool. I think you can even look, you can even launch a terminal there. Oh, I was not aware of this functionality yet, but okay, I need to configure some stuff there. Doesn't matter. Nice. So we had some content there. Perfect. We saved it, and let's see, we go to your projects. Should have now a project here. It's called Administrator Test. And if you go to that project, you have like a clone link here, right? And if you take this URL, and you see clone with SSH. So if you have that SSH key loaded, we have that here, of course, we should be able to do, let's go to the temp directory, by the way, like that, a git clone on that project. Let's see. Git was not found. I did not even install Git here. So yeah, of course, this is the Git server, and I'm now sort of impersonating a Git client. But it doesn't matter. We just install, yum, install Git. Just put it on there very quickly. Fix that. Some dependencies, of course, 31 even. That doesn't matter. It goes pretty quick, as you can see. Now I'm making mistakes as well, making these demos. And let's see if we can now do a Git clone. And we can, of course, the first time you always need to accept the key, right? We are just setting up a new session. Then after that, we need to specify the password for that file, and we're done. See? So we did clone that. So if I do it now directory listing, and I do cd test, I do their directory listing, and I do vi on the test file, right? I open the test file, and now I'm going to add some from shell. Escape, cc, git, it's git status, let's see. Git commit minus a minus m, adding line from shell, git push. Specify my password, there you go. And if you now go back to here, and we open this test file, you will see add some from shell. See that? Nice. And now we do the other way around. So for instance, I'll make a modification here again. So we edit this file, and doesn't matter. We'll save that. If we can, at least we commit those changes. We have that now committed. And how do you get that here? If you do a git pull, then you pull the changes here locally. And then I need to specify the password again. And then now one changes in the text file there. And that's correct. Because if we got that file, you will see now this line added. So let's go back to the demo. So we log in with the root. We did an SSH key creation. We set that on that account. We copied the content of that that file over to the user profile here, settings, SSH keys, and we created that here. You see your SSH key, and you can add more. You know, if you have more keys, you can add them, of course. So we did that, and now we created a new project. So with a couple of branches, that's perhaps, yeah. I think that's perhaps a nice concept to comprehend, so to speak. So let's go back to our projects, my project, I mean. And we have this administrator here. And honestly, I always do it on the command line, but this time I want to do it this way, because otherwise you won't teach anything. I think it's on repositories, branches. I think you can, yeah, new branch. And you can create a new branch, and we call it test. And the test branch comes from master. Okay, create that branch. And I'll show you some more tricks, by the way. And now we have a test branch as well. And imagine we're sitting here on this box still, and we do a git checkout test this time. Now we first do a git pull. Need to have the latest content. Still prompting for my key, so I did not automatically load that into my session, so forgive me for that. It doesn't matter. And now we do a git checkout on test. And now we switch to the test branch, git status. And now we're working on test. So if you now open that same test file, text file again, and we'll add some information. We add some information in the test branch. and we do git commit I am adding to test, git push, asking for my password again, doesn't matter, just for demo purposes. Perfect. And now, if we go back here in the test branch, I'm there. You know, we had some information to the test branch. We did that from that remote shell. And if you now go back to your master, of course, that's still in the same state. That doesn't have that line. Huh? That line. So for instance, you now have some wonderful code you created in your test branch here. So let's imagine that this is very wonderful that we have here this on line 6. And want to have that available in our master branch. We don't have that yet. So you can do that several ways, but you can do this for instance, git checkout master, git merge test. So what you're doing, you're picking up test and you merge it into master, right? We do that now. Git merge test, and then we do a git push, push those changes back to the master branch. And we need the password for that, of course. And there we go. And if we now go here to the master branch, we'll refresh that. Then we open this text file. We now also have that line here because we merged test into the master. And of course, you can make changes in master and push them to test as well. So that's sort of the mechanism on how branches work. Yeah, so we added the file and the folder. We did the git clone. We changed some stuff and pushed it back. We even did some extra changes, by the way. We even created branches. And we validated the changes in the web UI. Yes, let me think if I can make up of something else to explain, otherwise we're done. Yes, I'm quite satisfied. So this is the end of the part one of CI/CD. And this is the first part you need to have in place, so to speak. You need to have a version control and in place that you can use for SaltStack and Jenkins or other tools, Ansible, Puppet, whatever you use, need to have sort of version system up and running. And we now have that, and that's GitLab. So thanks for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video where we build a SaltStack server and integrate that with Git. Thanks for watching. Bye.